Oh god, it's about Tidal today.
Yeah.
Whatever.
So, I mean, honestly, at this point, it feels like straight up bullying whenever we talk about Tidal on this show.
Mm-hmm.
Since it debuted just over a year ago, touting itself as the streaming service for artists by artists, they pretty much right out the gate made it impossible for cynical assholes like us to not make fun of them at every chance. At this point, I've made Jay-Z's face look stupid on so many Tech Tuesday thumbnails that I feel bad about it. Because for the most part, I actually like Jay-Z.
We all do.
And most of the other people that co-own Tidal.
Yeah, that's not
the
problem.
I feel like a terrible person.
But they really do make it impossible for us to not make fun of them. And the latest reasons why are that Tidal is now threatening to sue its original pre-Jay-Z owners. And that Kanye West's album, Life of Pablo, only managed to be a Tidal exclusive for a month and a half. But let's start with that first part. Tidal may have debuted in March 2015, but it actually began as a service called Wimp back in 2010, with the name being changed to Tidal just a few months before it was bought by Jay-Z and relaunched in its current incarnation.
Jay-Z bought Tidal for $56 million,
mm-hmm.
and now he's demanding some of that money back from the Norwegian company that sold it to him, because according to Tidal's current owners, the original owners inflated Tidal's user base stats to get more money. In a statement, Tidal said, "It became clear after taking control of Tidal and conducting our own audit that the total number of subscribers was actually well below the 540,000 reported to us by the prior owners. As a result, we have now served legal notice to parties involved in the sale." Tidal is suing Tidal.
That's crazy. So one reason those numbers might have been inflated is because prior to Jay-Z's acquisition of Tidal, it came bundled with a few cable TV and mobile phone services in Europe. So it had subscribers, but not really people who had actively chosen to subscribe and didn't necessarily resubscribe when the bundle deals expired. Which is kind of ironic, since Tidal themselves inflate their own numbers nowadays by including non-paying subscribers simply using a free trial.
Anyway,
yeah.
In response, Schibsted, Tidal's original owners in Norway, released a statement saying, "We disagree with the accusations in the letter and any potential claims. We would like to point out that the company was listed on the stock exchange with everything that entails regarding transparent financial reporting."
So, wow. Whatever. Meanwhile, back in February, Kanye West released his highly anticipated album, The Life of Pablo, and decided at basically the last minute that it would be a Tidal exclusive. Forever. He tweeted on February 15th, "My album will never, never, never be on Apple. And it will never be for sale. You can only get it on Tidal."
Well, these days, never, never, never doesn't really mean what it used to.
Because you shouldn't say never should say never.
No. Last week, on April Fool's Day of all days, Kanye not only started selling the album as a digital download directly from his own website, but the album also can now be streamed on Apple Music, Google Play Music, and Spotify.
Probably a bunch of others, too.
And there hasn't really been any official explanation about Kanye and Tidal's change of heart about this whole thing.
Yep.
Honestly, if they had just said that the album wouldn't be released outside of Tidal for now, or for an undetermined amount of time, this wouldn't even be newsworthy. But the whole never, never, never thing makes them just look really foolish now, only 6 weeks later, doing something they say they would never do.
Yeah, so I don't know, maybe it has something to do with them suing themselves? Maybe they're just like, the writing's on the wall. I mean,
captain goes down with the ship.
Let's get as much money as we can from anywhere.
Yeah.
He's suing for some of his money back. That has to be a bad sign. You would think.
It's like, buy Tidal, the company that I... Subscribe to Tidal, the company I now regret buying in the first place.
Yeah. Anyways, hate to say we called it, but I mean, we've done enough reporting
on
this.
They last a lot longer than we originally
predicted. I said a year, so I think I still have a couple weeks, don't I?
No, they hit their 1 year anniversary back in March.
Whatever.
So we both lost.
In other news, Tesla finally unveiled their new Model 3 vehicle, which, unlike its much pricier predecessors, the Tesla Roadster, Model S, and Model X, will retail for a base price of just $35,000. And even though the Model 3 won't be available until the end of 2017, a year and a half from now, over 275,000 potential buyers have put down $1,000 to reserve one for themselves.
Jesus. Now, this is apparently a lot more than Tesla even expected themselves, though why they would think an affordable, beautiful, all-electric future car would only get 100,000 or less pre-orders is a little baffling, honestly.
Yeah.
They should have known this would happen.
They should have made the base price higher. A lot of these people that I've talked to that pre-purchased it, pretty much every single one of them actually has said, well, it's refundable, so if I want my money back at any time, I can take it. So I hope this doesn't bite them in the ass.
It's a zero-interest bank account.
Yeah.
Anyway, all of this demand and attention for the Model 3 means that Tesla's manufacturing arm is going to have to step up its game a lot compared to their previous cars, And some are predicting that the Model 3 rollout could stretch all the way into 2019 or 2020. And that includes people who put down the $1,000 here in 2016.
Well, they haven't even built the facility yet.
Yeah, they're like, oh, fuck, we gotta make a lot of cars.
Oh, they have, they're like, hey, everyone, look. Look at this beautiful facility that doesn't exist yet. That's where we're gonna make these cars.
This is like Kickstarter's gone wrong on a, like, a really, really, really high scale.
We're like, this is gonna end up just like that Coolest Cooler.
Yeah, we know how to make cars, but 500,000 cars?
You guys are crazy. Listen, guys, the blender inside the Tesla 3 is not working out the way that we want it to.
Where is my refund?
There's going to be a lot of bad Amazon reviews for this car. I'll wait till it's available on Prime Instant Shipping, and then I'll get it. Anyways, the whole thing is pretty damn ridiculous. It's ridiculous to do a pre-order like this, but like we said, it's a beautiful, groundbreaking car, and it could single-handedly steer the entire auto industry in a new direction. We're kind of glad that we didn't empty our bank accounts to get on that list for it, but it's pretty cool that so many other people did.
Yeah.
It shows that there's interest.
You put the money down. I'll just sit here and watch and drive my Honda.
Thanks for evolving automotive creation for the rest of us.
You are the risk takers. You are the innovators.
Like I said, I think it's a great thing for the automotive industry
because
it shows how much interest there are, and I think that other traditional manufacturers are going to have to kick up their game and push out more electric cars and innovate. And this car is a perfect example of what people want in a car, so they can take that and
disruptive technology. It's gonna, once these things actually hit the market, I think
you're
gonna
see. Look at these morons! They're paying $1,000 for nothing. We can make cars right now like that.
Yeah, all we have to do is promise something that doesn't exist.
Yeah, I don't know. I think it's great that people pre-ordered it. I have a lot of faith in Elon Musk and Tesla. Me personally, don't want to take the risk. And I really hope it doesn't come back to bite them with that pre-order being refundable thing.
I hope so too. They're fine though, they got a lot of money.
I was out eating dinner and my friend that I was with put the $1,000 down. He was just like, that's refundable.
It's okay. Putting the money down is...
It's a status symbol.
Yeah, it's less about even the car that you're ordering. It's just like, I put the money down. I have $1,000 to just throw around.
Yeah, yeah. It's anyone with a $1,000 credit limit, which should be pretty much anyone over the age of 18, could put the fucking money down and get this thing on their Facebook page that says, oh, I just pre-ordered Tesla.
Pre-ordered it.
Oh, come on. Get out of here. Yeah. It's ridiculous. It's the new Yeezys.
Stop talking about Tidal and Jay-Z and Kanye West. Anyway, since you guys liked what Phil had to say so much last week, let's bring back our pal Phil Larigo. He's going to tell you all about a potential new law that might actually make internet service providers in this country suck just a tiny bit less.
It's real tech news with Phil.
What's the best part about being a cable customer? The customer service wait times, right?
Yeah.
Comcast, winner of the most hated company in America, yes, that's an actual award they've won, well, they've helped spawn a bill that would make it easier to cancel your service.
Woo-hoo!
Let me clarify. They didn't actually help propose the bill. They simply were so horrible at what they were doing, providing a service to customers, that Los Angeles Assemblyman Mike Gatto introduced a bill that could allow customers to cancel their service with one click. One click!
Woo!
So instead of tracking down the customer service number, navigating the impenetrable maze of their phone tree, sitting on hold, verifying information with the rep, explaining you want to cancel your service, sitting through retention speech, being transferred, explaining to that, no, you really want to cancel your service. Seriously, dude, finally, they're going to cancel my service. When you hang up the phone, you're like, did they actually do it?
Nope. Well,
if this bill passes, you could just log on their website, click, and you're done. So how do we get here? In 2014, Comcast got a little too Comcastic and bullied the wrong customer. Ryan Block.
That's Comcastic.
They're just like, yeah, with a drill.
Yeah.
This guy, Ryan Block, co-hosted the MVP with Ryan and Peter podcast. He tried to cancel his cable service over the phone. The customer service rep simply wouldn't let him cancel, and Block was forced to endure an 18-minute call with a rep who was going above and beyond in all the wrong ways. Luckily, the dude recorded this clip, posted it, and it went viral. Here's the thing. Ryan Block used to be the editor-in-chief of Engadget. Not everybody who wants to cancel their service has a technical and legal understanding. This guy does. It'd be amazing if there was always a white knight to protect customers from the evils of horrific customer service. But come on, have you ever had to give your parents tech support over the phone? It's bad. Anything over the phone is awful. So companies want to make it as easy as possible for you to hand over your money. Amazon patented one-click purchasing. You can pay for a thing on your phone by just putting your fingerprint on it, and you can even order Domino's by tweeting a pizza emoji at them. I wonder what happens if you tweet a poop emoji at them.
You get to shit in a box.
Same thing. Okay.
Yeah, the customer's always right, Phil.
They're always right. Life in 2016 has gotten really, really convenient, and it boggles my mind that to turn off my cable service, I have to pick up the phone and dial a bunch of numbers before I get in an argument with a stranger to stop taking my money. If Ryan's Law passes, that's what they're calling this thing, Ryan's Law, it could pave the way for similar laws that could go nationwide. So let's all root for Ryan and his little law so we can spend less time on the phone and more time online leaving Comcast horrific reviews.
Woo! Woo! They're gonna have to do a little bit of better marketing on that law name. It's not like Ryan's a child abduction law.
We got a Ryan alert. There's a little boy being kidnapped by his dad.
Elliot, you work for Comcast, and I'm calling to cancel my service. Let's do a little.
All right.
I've been on hold for 20 minutes. Maybe we can do this all day. Just pick up.
Oh, hello, sir. Can you hold?
No, I've been online for I've been on the line for 20 minutes.
Okay. What do you need?
I'd like to cancel my service.
Nope.
It's my account. I just want to cancel it. That's
How about this?
Okay.
We'll give you twice the internet for twice the price.
What's twice the internet mean?
You know, like the gigawatts.
Okay.
We're the fastest network in the network sphere.
That's not true. I've heard a lot of stuff about this Google Fiber.
Never heard of it.
If you just go on Google it.
We sent you an email in your Comcast email account about it. Just go log into your Comcast email.
Listen, I just want to, just save yourself, I just want to cancel.
Have we told you about our new routers?
No, I have.
They're
I
the best
my,
routers.
I bought my own router.
Why would you do that when so you can rent one from us in perpetuity?
Listen, that's fine. You don't even have to pick anything up. Just let me cancel.
I'm gonna think about that.
And that's how it goes.
Yeah. And so on.
Yeah.
And scene.
Yeah. So just a couple more quick squirts before we go. Starting with Amazon Dash. Last year around this time, Amazon unveiled their annual April Fool's prank, a bunch of little buttons that you stick to the wall in your house and press whenever you need to re-up on that specific product. A new shipment is then automatically sent, arriving 2 business days later. How ridiculous, right? Humans are lazy, but come on.
Well, it turned out it wasn't actually a prank. It was a real thing. And now, a year later, and again, way too close to April 1st, they've expanded their Dash button selection. This is just great news for people of all walks of life.
Yeah.
For example, if you bang chicks so often that you lack the energy to get out of bed and walk to the convenience store, there's a Trojan button to get you more condoms.
Yeah.
And if you want to be a terrible neckbearding gamer stereotype, you can get buttons for Doritos, Red Bull, and Slim Jim.
But you can only get so much filthy Dorito dust on the button before it stops working.
Yeah, you might need to get a new button after a while. You wash your finger before you press it.
Yeah.
There's over 100 Dash buttons now. And what sounded like a ridiculous idea originally, and still sounds like a ridiculous idea, has apparently been a success. At least according to Amazon.
Hey, I saw one of these things in real life when I was over enjoying Easter Sunday at my friend's house. It was too tempting. I pressed it. And now, I'm sorry, Pags, but you have some new cleaning solution coming to your door, thanks to me.
Yep.
It's just sitting there. A child could press it, and technically, one did.
It's too easy.
Yeah. So, I'll give you like $5 if you're actually pissed, but it was just sitting there.
Sorry, Pags.
Yeah.
Shouldn't have left that Dash button out. Anyway, next up, apparently Reddit has recently been subpoenaed by either the FBI or NSA to turn over data in some way.
Yeah.
We don't know this because of something Reddit said about it. We know this because of what they didn't say about it.
Yeah.
See, when a company receives what are called national security letters from the FBI or Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act letters from the NSA, it's illegal for that company to disclose that information to the public.
Yeah, so one way that companies circumvent this rule is by using what are called, quote, warrant canaries, referring to the old practice of bringing canaries down into mines to detect dangerous gas levels when the canary dies. In Reddit's case, the warrant canary has been something they include in their annual transparency report, basically saying, as of right now, Reddit has never received a national security letter or Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act letter or any other classified request for information.
Well, this year's Reddit transparency report doesn't have that, meaning that sometime in the last year, they have been approached by a government agency with a warrant that compels them to cooperate in an investigation without telling anyone.
Mm-hmm.
That's all that they can really do, but thankfully sharp-eyed readers picked up on that omission. And it's really anyone's guess what the government was snooping around on Reddit for, but at some point last year, that's what they did.
They were looking
at what porn you look at!
And the dankest memes.
Yeah, and they were also like,
Whoa. We've seen a few too many of these rare Pepes showing up in the black market.
Weapons-grade dank memes.
Yeah. Oh, God. Anyways, we have some other content over here that you have to check out. We did a brand new podcast with Charlotte Copley and Ilya Naishuler.
Yeah. Eli Nyshuler.
There we go. About the movie Hardcore Henry, it was we had a blast. It's super interesting.
Yeah, they gave us Henry's arm.
They said
ow, Henry.
It's very hard. And also, We also have a new episode of News Dump where we talk about the possibility of an Obi-Wan Kenobi movie. And I'm sure that everyone out there by now is wondering what the fuck the Panama Papers are. We did our best to digest it and spit it back out in a way that is somewhat easier to understand.
It wild.
It wild. So check that over here. We'll see you guys next time.
Bye.